Johnny Dollar.
Freddie Friedkin, Johnny, over here at Mono Guarantee Insurance.
Freddie, how are you?
Oh, same as always. Listen, now, why don't you do me a favor?
If I can.
Ever hear of an old dame by the name of Mrs. Ambrose Winifred Van Turkle?
Ambrose, what?
Van Turkle.
No, I'm happy to say I haven't.
Yeah, I guess you have a point there. Nancy's an old five budget. Lives over on South Tyrone, 1227.
South Tyrone? She must be loaded.
Yeah, it depends on how you look at it. But we have written a bit of insurance on her jewelry. And Johnny.
How much?
Just under $2 million. And Johnny.
You're kidding.
Not a bit. But now listen.
My regular commission on $1 million?
Now listen, will
you? Freddie, say no more. I'll take the case.
CBS Radio Network brings you Mandel Kramer in the exciting adventures of the man with the action-packed expense account. America's fabulous freelance insurance investigator, yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Expense account submitted by Special Investigator Johnny Dollar to Mono Guarantee Insurance Company, Hartford, Connecticut. Following is an account of expenses incurred during my investigation of the Too Many Crooks matter. You know, they say that too many crooks spoil the broth. Well, believe me, too many crooks can certainly mess up an insurance investigation. I know. Expense account item 1, $460 to fill the gas tank on my car. Then I drove to Freddie Friedkin's office down in the square. He was waiting for me out front. Okay, Freddie, let's have it.
Well, look, if you hadn't hung up the phone already...
I think it must be pretty urgent. Your standing here says I was right. So, what goes with this Van Turkle dame and her $1 million worth of jewelry?
I told you, and that's why she's an important client. I understand, incidentally, she keeps it all out there at her home.
She does, hmm?
And that's fine with us. Makes the premiums that much higher.
What's happened to her, Freddie?
Her? Well, not a thing, nothing at all. It's what happens to me.
What do you mean?
Well, it's the day off for all her servants, including the chauffeur.
No.
I promised to drive her in here to the office this morning to go over some of her policies.
Well, Fred...
Well, now, if I don't, the old fuss pot is liable to blow a gasket and cancel everything. And she would.
You mean that's all you called me about?
So the first vice president in charge of me has just arrived in town, and that means I don't dare leave this place.
Well, Freddie, I was signing a commission on...
So I told her you'd drive her in here.
You what?
And, Johnny, I don't know what this power is that you seem to have over these old biddies, but... She knows all about you. Listens to every program every week and thinks you're wonderful.
Freddie, flattery will get you nowhere.
Look, instead of chewing me out, she said fine. She'd get all tricked up in her Sunday best and be waiting for
me. Oh, Freddie, look.
And I'm serious, Johnny. This is really important.
Am I supposed to wear a uniform and chauffeur's cap?
I'm not kidding. It is important, very. Will you do it as a favor to me?
As a favor to you?
Yeah.
No.
Now, Johnny.
But I will for another reason.
Oh?
I would just like to have a look at the female who can throw such a scare into fearless Freddie Friedkin. I drove to the CCU residential section on South Tyrone Avenue. Number 1227 was one of those huge, once very fashionable brownstone affairs surrounded with broad lawns, formal gardens, and plenty of stately elms. The winding driveway led to a porte cochere on one side. I pulled into it, gave the horn a couple of polite things, and waited. Looks like a lady could really buzz one service. Well. When I finally saw the light again, the birds out there in the trees were singing merrily. But to my aching head, it sounded like they were screaming. I just lay there for a minute or two, trying to collect my wits. Whoever given me that cloud over the head had really done a good job of it. It made sure I'd stay out of circulation long enough for him to... But wait a minute. I'd had just one glimpse of him in a brief second when I'd opened that door. William McPeak. That's what it was. William McPeak, slugger in second story, man, with a record as long as you're on. With old Mrs. Van Kirker alone in this big house. Painfully to get back on my feet. Mrs. Van Kirker? Mrs. Van Kirker?
I found her slumped over in a chair in a sort of morning room. She'd been struck over the head crazy and hard. She was breathing, but only faintly. I grabbed the telephone.
Doctor, listen.
Yes?
This is Johnny Dollar. I'm over here at Mrs. Van Pickle's place.
Oh, yes, Johnny. She's a patient of mine.
Listen to me, Doctor, will you? Somebody got in here and hit her over the head and she's in bad shape.
What?
I don't know whether she'll live.
I'll be there right away.
You better. Another call, this time to headquarters from Sergeant Harry Dean, who promised to send somebody pronto. Then, after throwing Ashley in with Mrs. Van Pickle, I looked around. Finally, I found it in the library. The oil painting pushed aside. In back of it, the wall safe. Broken open and very empty. On the floor, a single wound that apparently had been dislodged from the setting. I dropped it in my pocket and made another phone call.
Hello.
Pretty, Johnny.
But where are you, Johnny? What happened? Go out there and pick her up?
Listen to me, Freddy.
Yeah?
How much did you say you've insured the jewelry for?
Well, close to $1 million. Why?
You better get ready to send her a check.
What?
If she stays alive.
This ever happened to you? You're driving down a long highway or working late, and then monotony makes you feel drowsy. Perk up with Nodos. Nodos keeps you alert with the same safe refresher found in coffee. Yet Nodos is faster, handier, more reliable. Absolutely not habit forming. The safe way to stay alert without harmful stimulants. Nodos.
On the phone and sent an ambulance out.
Mm-hmm.
He's gonna try, but he's not sure if he can pull it through.
Good. Listen, Harry.
That reminds me.
Yeah?
An old friend of yours just left town only about an hour ago at our request.
Friend of mine? Who?
An old strong arm by the name of Willie McPeak.
Willie? What?
Yeah, we helped him onto a train to New York.
Oh, fine.
Told him we just don't like his looks around here.
Harry, he is the man.
What?
Didn't you know? He's not only a strong-arm specialist, but he has enough raps against him for burglary to fill a book.
But our records here only show a couple of arrests over the years.
I don't hear what they show, Harry. He's the one I found there at Mrs. Van Turkle's house, the one who belted me over the head.
Oh, and we helped him out of town.
You sure did.
Okay, Johnny, okay. I'll notify the New York Police Department right away to grab him for us.
If they can find him. And you know how long it'll take just to get the wheels turning, get all the red tape out of the way?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, brother. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe I can find him.
Wow, Johnny.
A little local knowledge, Harry.
About him?
About him and about some other people down there. I'll see you later. Item 2-1045, plane affairs in New York. And I was lucky. A flight took off just a few minutes after I got to Bradley Field. Item 3 in the big city, $4 even for a cab into 18th Street Bank headquarters. Before even talking to my old pal, Lieutenant Manning Center, I appropriated a phone in the office next to his and made 5 calls to men who were always ready to dig up a little information from me for a price. Then I walked into Randy's office.
Okay. Now, what's it all about, Johnny? You can make all those calls to him there.
Randy, if I told you, you'd probably round them all up and toss them in the jug.
Well, it's feelings, eh?
Right. And they're a lot more valuable to me on the loose.
Are you sure you haven't better tell me who they are so we can, sort of protect them for you?
Uh-huh.
The department's going to always use them like to talk to Katie, you know, Johnny.
Randy, I'd rather not.
Okay, but Stop tapping that diamond or whatever it is on the top of my desk, will you? Want to scratch the glass?
This diamond is what I came here about.
Well, Johnny, you're fixing to pick a bit of gold in Michigan down here in Chester.
Why, I was trying
to... Well, everything. Central's on our Mexican. There's a lot of funny gold circulating around.
Oh?
Places so darn good, it takes an expert to tell the bad tens and twenties from the good ones.
How does it mean?
Yes and no. I mean, when you say ring, you're pretty up to those boys around here, Johnny. I mean, you've got to see that almost all of them.
Almost all of them?
Well, of course, the federal boys are beating their brains out, too. But what's happening is this.
Yeah?
Every time we knock over a print shop that's been making the stuff, we get there too late.
How do you mean?
Well, the place is gone. Been sold to someone else.
Mm.
And not just to another printer, Johnny. That's what the crackdown really is. I hope. But to some intermediary, some brain who plants them with another printer just long enough to get out a nickel and then pass them on to somebody else.
Well, maybe you better shut down every print shop in town, man.
Oh, sure. You know what it takes? Just one little crack tucked away in somebody's basement. City this size, it could be thousands of them. But the department's raising cane, the feds are complaining we aren't cooperating, I feel lousy. And what's your problem?
William McTeague.
McTeague? Well, he hasn't been active for a long time.
Oh, he hasn't, hmm?
Ambitious, really? Yeah. Always on the way to something big and always on up in the place.
Now, let me tell you now, Randy.
Excuse me.
Yeah? No.
We tried peddling baseball for a while, Johnny. 2 years up the river. Tried just making another turn. Tried half a dozen rackets. Always fell on his face. The only thing he could seem to get away with was a burglary and safe job.
Well, he can't this time, so listen.
Now, look, Johnny, I'd like to help you a little. Will you stop tapping that thing?
Nearly $1 million worth of jewels.
I don't care if it's... Down here?
No, up in Hartford, but I need your help.
Well, Johnny, until we get official fix from the boys up there, you know how it is.
I mean, a little deal between you and me has to be official all of a sudden.
Oh, no, of course not. But will you stop scratching that diamond on the glass, huh?
Okay, Randy.
Well, wait. Yeah? This? Who? Yeah. The who, Johnny?
Oh? Johnny Dollar.
Spotty.
Oh, Yes, Spotty.
Spotty who?
This nubby give me a headquarters.
Oh, don't worry about that. That's where I am. Go ahead.
You wouldn't pull one on me, Johnny.
Yeah, Spotty, you know me better than that.
Yeah, I guess I do.
You got something for me?
Say, a couple of C-notes, Johnny?
That's 100, Spotty. If you get me anywhere, then it's two.
Okay. Just a couple of minutes ago, with a briefcase on him.
Yeah.
718 East 49th.
I got it.
He pokes the buzzer for number 2A, and then he goes in.
Okay.
Now, what does that mean?
You know anybody that's over 849 Street, Mary?
Should I?
I'll let you know.
Now, wait, Johnny. I thought you wanted some help.
I may not need it now.
Oh, no? Well, now, wait a minute. Maybe you...
I didn't pay a dollar even for a cab to the Mustang 16-year-old apartment building on East 49th Street. I quickly pushed the button for each apartment. They all must have been out here, the tenants were going out, because nobody pushed open the lock on the front door for me. So I flipped the lock, and I quietly went inside and up the stairs to the door of 2A. Drop your gun. Kick it over here. Come on.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, now sit down over there against the wall. Let me take a look at you. Looks like you killed him, Willie.
Sheriff's back out on me.
But if you figure on keeping this mess of jewels and whatever it was he gave you for them. What was it, Willie? What did he give you for them? Let me take a look at his briefcase here. Don't move, Willie.
Okay. You got the gun.
Is that
comes through like the taste of a Newport Scissor cigarette. Fresh, clear. Like the voice of a girl you used to know. Listen. There's a difference, all right. Like when you light up, you're so sweet. Man, he's never tasted anything like it. Good, rich tobacco flavor. The right amount of menthol. Just a hint of cool, refreshing mint. So, what is it that fellow Miss Marshall says about Newport? Are there any questions, man? Questions? No. I got the message. Newport, more refreshing to Virginia, more refreshing all the way. Newport.
Again.
Johnny, where are you calling from?
718 East 49.
Well, listen, I just...
Apartment 2A.
There's a guy living over there we've been looking at for years.
There was, Randy.
Name of Horace Petersley, a passer of hot jewelry, that sort of stuff, you know? Only we never have been able to... Hey, what'd you say? What?
That's right, he's dead.
Okay, I'll be right over.
No, Randy.
Hmm? What do you mean?
Send somebody else.
Well, now, listen, Johnny, if you knocked him off, I mean, even...
Somebody else killed him, Randy. The punk I have sitting here at the other end of my gun.
Who?
You stay right there in your office, and I'll be along in a couple of minutes with the Van Turkle jewels and with William McPeak himself.
You're kidding.
Not a bit.
And that's all the more reason I better get over there.
No, Randy, because while you're waiting for us, I want you to get hold of Fritz Melchior.
That, gemologist?
Yes. Tell him to get there immediately with all of his equipment.
Well, I don't get it, Johnny.
You will, Randy, you will. Item 4, another dollar for another cab. Luckily, by the time we got to headquarters, Melchior, the gemologist, was there and waiting. I handed him the Van Circle jewels and told him to set up his equipment on Randy's desk and get to work.
Now, it's going to take the ultraviolet lamp a moment or two to get warmed up, Mr. Dollar.
Well, that's perfectly all right, Mr. Melchior.
In the meantime, I'll just set up this retail refractor meter. And the
money. Just take your time.
But why can't we just book Willie and lock him up, Johnny? Conroy's going to get tired sitting there holding a gun on him.
Yeah, it's time
to go. And he sees what I think he's going to see. He wished that he had that gun to shoot himself with. Talk to you, by the way.
What do you mean by that?
I remember. It seems to me I got a little annoyed earlier when I sat here at the glass top desk fooling around with the stone that Willie left behind at Mrs. Van Tiffle's.
But sure, you kept tapping, and rubbing it over the glass, trying to scratch.
That's just the point, Randy. Rubbing it on the glass, but not strengthening it.
Johnny,
you tell me, is there a single scratch there?
No. No, Johnny, you're right. Son of a gun.
No, of course, it isn't absolutely conclusive. I make no bones about it. It didn't sink in at all while I was doing it. But when I heard the now deceased Horace Petersley back there in his apartment, when I heard him telling Willie that the deal was off to give him back the plate, it suddenly dawned on me.
Yeah, so maybe we've got more crooks on this deal than we bargained for, huh? Too many crooks.
Mm-hmm. Including a little old lady who figured on collecting nearly $1 million on that stuff that Mr. Melchior is looking at.
Hey, now, listen, what do you mean by that?
All right, hold it down.
Well, Mr. Melchior?
Gentlemen, there is no question about it.
Are you sure, sir?
I am absolutely certain. Now, look here, please. You too, Lieutenant.
Yeah?
You see, I used a polished piece of corona. Now, does the so-called diamond scratch it? No. The corundum wears away the stone. And here, the test with the refractometer is further proof.
With the what?
The refractometer. It measures the deviation from a straight line suffered by a ray of light in passing obliquely through various media of varying density. Now, look here. Under the ultraviolet light. Now, you see?
Well, that's pretty, Mr. Melchior.
Now, that is a genuine diamond, Lieutenant, that I brought along for comparison. But, now look at this one. Under the black light.
Supposedly precious jewels insured by Mrs. Van Tuffle.
Quite so, Mr. Dollar. They're strapped, faced, common glass. They're not valuable gems.
What are you, some kind of a nut?
Although some of them have been very
Hang on, Conway.
It ain't true. It's a lie. It ain't true. I took him out of that safe myself. I had to kill a man to make a deal with him.
No, it ain't true.
It's true, all right, Willie.
Then I've been robbed.
Get him out of here, Conway. Lock him up. I've been robbed.
Well, Johnny, much as I hate to admit it, you've kind of done yourself a good day's work.
Well, of course, Willie had to do.
Hell, sure.
He got hold of those counterfeit plates for you, Randy, didn't he?
Uh-huh.
And he took care of that Peterson character for you, too. So, Andy, why don't you be a nice guy and see that he doesn't get more than a couple of life terms. As for the phony jewels, well, old Mrs. Van Persie has completely recovered from her beating, by the way. Set us straight. The real gem she always carefully kept in her vault in the bank. The paste that she had there in the wall safe were for casual wear. Expense account total, including the payoff to my friend Spotty. Call it 200.5. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
When you get premium gasoline performance at regular gasoline price, find out what so many other car owners have found. In 3 out of 5 cars, regular price Sinclair Dino Gasoline matches performance of premium gasoline. Saves you up to 4 cents a gallon. Almost anywhere you see the Sinclair sign, you can save up to 4 cents a gallon with Dino and still get premium performance and mileage. Drive with care and buy Sinclair Dino Gasoline. Johnny Dollar is written by Jack Johnstone, produced and directed by Fred Hendrickson. Music supervision by Ethel Huber. Sound patterns by Walter Otto. Johnny Dollar is played by Mandel Kramer. Also featured in our cast were Court Denson, Jim Stevens, Tom Gorman, Jackson Beck, Sam Gray, Maurice Kaufman, and Bill Smith. Be sure to join us next week, same time, same station, for another exciting story of Yours Truly, Johnny Dollar. Aunt Hannah speaking. Hear Coleman on sports 10 times each weekend on the CBS Radio Network.
This is KRLD, AM and FM, Dallas.
If everybody's passing you on the highway, chances are you're going too slow. The too slow driver, the lane changer, inattentiveness on the part of experienced drivers whose driving skills have become automatic, are the real menaces on the highway. Sudden stops and slowdowns invite rear-end collisions. Try to maintain an even speed, neither much faster nor much slower than the flow of traffic. Follow other vehicles at a safe distance. Remember, at 60 miles an hour, under good conditions, it still takes 23 car lengths to stop. Friends, this is Kelly Mattis, Executive Secretary of the Citizens Traffic Commission, asking you to take stock of your driving habits. Don't be a slow-poke driver and don't be a speed demon. Drive at a speed that is safe and prudent. Safe and prudent not only for you, but for others that are driving on the same street or highway. Driving too slow can be just as dangerous as driving too fast.